So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Dr. Eric Weiner. Dr. Weiner, as you can see, holds multiple titles, and this is just at Dana-Farber, let alone across his many roles in breast cancer nationally and internationally. But he is the chief of the Division of Breast Oncology Center at the Susan F. Smith Center for Women's Cancers and the chief of the Division of Women's Cancers at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. He's a professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School. If you are one of Dr. Weiner's patients, you know how what wonderful care you are given or provided by Dr. Weiner and his team, including Jen McKenna. And what you may or may not recognize is how much influence he's had on how we care for breast cancer patients really internationally, both through his training of oncology professionals who go on to many places around the world and take the lessons that they've learned from Dr. Weiner, as well as guideline committees and other influential roles, which really guide how oncologists take care of cancer patients with breast cancer around the world. So without further, he's going to be very embarrassed because he doesn't like these kind of introductions, but just introduce Eric.
Thank you, Nancy. So I just have to comment about chocolate. Rest assured that as an American, you are way low on the worldwide chocolate consumption. And I just happened to look up this fun fact. So in the United States, the per capita chocolate consumption is about 9.5 pounds per year. However, if you move to Europe, and in particular, if you go to Switzerland, it's twice that. And even in Australia, it's something like 15 pounds a year. So everybody needs to go out on Halloween and get more chocolate. So I want to thank Nancy in particular for putting together not only today's program, but for this entire Embrace program, which was an idea that she conceived of now probably 7 or 8 years ago, and has really, I think, been of great benefit both individually to our patients, to patients at large, and also very much in terms of our research program. I also want to acknowledge Liz Frank, who leads our advocacy group, and Sarah Hoffman, who are the co-chairs today. And finally, where's Melissa? There she is. She had a camera before. But Melissa Hughes, who at least today is sort of playing a slightly more behind-the-scenes role, but who coordinates many of our programs and is just instrumental in all of this work. And then I want to thank all of you for coming, because by coming, you help us understand more about what we need to do and where we're going. And it's both helpful for you to be here, I hope, and helpful for all of us. So I was asked to talk about some changes in our program, and in particular, I'm going to talk about some opportunities we've had just in the past year because of some funding and what we're doing with it. Then I'm just going to make a couple of very, very brief comments about where the field is going, and then I'll turn it back over to whoever I'm turning it over to, back to Nancy. We're very, very pleased this year to be awarded once again a breast cancer SPOR grant. SPOR stands for Specialized Program in Research Excellence. This is a grant that comes from the National Cancer Institute. It takes probably 1,000 person hours to put it together. It's an exhausting process, but it does provide a great deal of funding, and there are only 5 of them given out in the United States in breast cancer. And what this is allowing us to do is to focus on 4 very specific areas. I'll just briefly mention them. So one is how we can make what are called CDK4/6 inhibitors, or drugs like Ibrance, how we can make them work better, both in women who have estrogen receptor positive breast cancer, as well as an area where they've typically not been used, which is patients who have triple negative breast cancer. The second project looks at HER2 positive breast cancer, an area where arguably we've made so much progress that maybe we should focus a little less there than in other areas, although the truth is we still have many, many unmet needs there, and we still need to push harder to get to the top of the mountain and to really solve that problem. And the project is focusing on combining different types of immune-based approaches with standard anti-HER2 therapies. And I should mention that all of these projects have a basic science component, so work going on in the laboratory, and a clinical component. So it's allowing us to bring together researchers who do very different things, researchers who do clinical trials, and researchers who are focused on laboratory experiments. And that's really how we're going to make changes in the years ahead. The third project is one that actually Nancy co-leads. And is a project that is very important, and it focuses on the challenging situation when metastatic breast cancer has spread to the brain. There have been, over the course of the past few decades, relatively few clinical trials and work focused exclusively on the brain. We have actually probably had more trials than most places. I would say, run probably 30 such trials in the last 10 years. But it's an area where we really need to do better, and there are a lot of complicated scientific issues. You may have heard about something called the blood-brain barrier, which prevents drugs from getting into the brain because your brain is important and you don't want poisons going to your brain. And that can be a problem at times. A problem meaning that that blood-brain barrier blocks drugs from getting into the brain. But more and more recently, we've come to believe that blood-brain barrier is less of a problem, and perhaps the bigger challenge is that the brain environment is fundamentally different than elsewhere in your body. And so drugs that may work in your bones don't necessarily work as well in the brain, possibly because of with some changes in the cancer there, but also because of changes in the surrounding tissue. And finally, the last project is a project that again focuses on triple negative breast cancer and is looking at combining immunotherapy, which you're going to hear from Sarah in a little later, is an area where there's been a lot of progress in terms of clinical trials and specifically in terms of immunotherapy. But of course, immunotherapy by itself is probably not enough for patients who have advanced triple negative breast cancer. And so it's looking at combining some targeted agents, drugs like PARP inhibitors, which have been used in particular for patients who have BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutations, combining those drugs and some other drugs with immunotherapy to see if we can do better. And once again, it goes from the lab to the clinic. And the great thing about the SPORE, apart from letting us work on these four projects, is that it turns out to be a nidus for all sorts of research. And so it brings together researchers from across Dana-Farber and really across the entire Harvard campus. The other item I want to share with you is that we were very, very fortunate to receive a $20 million gift from a obviously very wealthy and very generous family to focus exclusively on the problem of metastatic estrogen receptor positive breast cancer. And this is something that they were very, very passionate about in making this gift. They were absolutely insistent that 100% of the money had to go into this work. And it's a gift that was made, that was pledged over 3 years, although it's going to be hard for us to spend that kind of money in 3 years. And so we're making it into a 5-year program. And we've put together a steering committee, and we have an external advisory committee. And we're really just in the initial phases of thinking through exactly what we're going to do with that. In all likelihood, we're going to do some of the old a little bit better and a lot of the new. So there are some programs we have ongoing, research programs that need a little help, and we'll boost those up. But very much we want to use this to try to begin to think more out of the box and take some what might be risky questions and ask them. You know, when you apply for money from the federal government, from the National Cancer Institute, you basically have to know the answer before you apply for the money. And what gifts like this allow us to do is to do very early phase work that may really lead to, you know, the home run in 5 or 10 years. Now, all of this comes in the background of what is really dramatic progress that has been made over the past decade or so. And I know for many of you, it doesn't feel like it's going fast enough, and it isn't. But the truth is, 15 years ago, we would go to our national meetings, and we wouldn't hear much that was new. And now, on a several time a year basis, there are new drugs or new approaches that are coming out for women and occasionally men with metastatic breast cancer that truly make a difference. And that's true in HER2-positive breast cancer, and it's been true recently in estrogen receptor-positive metastatic breast cancer, and it's even true now with the knowledge that immunotherapy can be effective in some patients and with some other new drugs. It's true in triple-negative breast cancer as well. So I really do think that the rate of progress, or there's been an acceleration in progress over the course of the past few years. And I think that's going to continue. Now, the key for all of you is we've got to make it even faster. And we're trying. I think that there's really good reason to be hopeful about the years ahead and about new treatments that are on the horizon. And finally, I just got the 5 minutes signed, but I'm going to be less than 5 minutes. I actually just want to say something that I think I've said here before, but I'm reassured by the fact that half of you haven't been here before, so you're not sick of hearing this from me. But for us, and there are 30 of us medical oncologists here who exclusively take care of women with breast cancer, and certainly a large number of women with metastatic breast cancer. Now, many of those people do other things in addition to clinical work. They're in the laboratory, they're doing administrative work, they're doing education, but those 30 people don't take care of any patients other than patients with breast cancer. But for those 30 people, taking care of all of you and the many other patients, the hundreds of patients we have with metastatic breast cancer, is both a challenge and it's a gift for us. Because from a scientific standpoint, it helps us understand where we need to go and what questions we need to ask. And from a very personal perspective, it's having those relationships with all of you that keep us going. That doctor-patient interaction, nurse-patient interaction, caregiver-patient interaction is so very important. I just wouldn't underestimate it for a second. It means so much to us. I hope it works from your perspective. It's something we really put a lot of effort into and care about very deeply. So with that, I think I'm going to close my remarks and tell you all to have a great day. Interestingly, on the other side of the third floor, we have a symposium going on for our regional collaborators. So these are centers around New England that work closely with us. And so while we're trying to do a little education and support for all of you, we're also trying to work with people throughout the region to make it that much more easier for the kind of care that we believe we provide to be provided closer to home in many cases. So thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you very much. So I have a couple of additional remarks, and then I'll introduce our first speaker. Now it will be at the third, I guess. It depends on your count. So first, I wanted to just thank you, Eric. I wanted to just give a brief overview of what the EMBRACE clinical program does. And then I'll talk with you in a little bit more in the weeds detail about some of the things I think that give me a lot of hope as far as where we're going in metastatic breast cancer. So what the Embrace program does is it provides patient education and support. So we organize this forum, newsletters by both print and email, and webcasts. Our team supports your Dana-Farber oncology team. We put together a central database of information that's useful to take care of you. It includes clinical trial matching and organized tumor testing. And we also assist in coordinating care with local oncologists, including reconsultations at times of worsening of cancer and communication. And we do this with four Embrace coordinators, Lauren Buckley, Libby Grant, Sarah Hoffman, and Julie Kasparian, and some of you may have interacted with them in the clinic. And they're all ably led by Melissa Hughes, who is taking pictures back there. In terms of our milestones, so we launched a very small-scale research study called Embrace in January of 2010. This was staffed by basically me and one recent college grad. And over the years, as of October of 2019, over 2,500 people have enrolled in the Embrace research program. We went live with a clinical program in August of 2016, and as of October 2019, we have over 3,000 patients who have been enrolled in the program. And what have Embrace participants contributed? Well, the surveys and feedback that you fill out have directly led to the clinical program overall, to the webcast content, to the content of the annual forum and our newsletter content. For those who participate in the Embrace research study, the blood samples that you provide at regular intervals have actually directly led to the development of technology to quantify tumor DNA in the blood, to show it corresponds very closely with what we see on a biopsy, and it changes in response to treatment. And our ongoing work is trying to understand, again, from these same samples, how cancers become resistant to treatment, because we can link the information about how people have done with their treatment and the information we gain from the blood samples. Many of you have contributed tissue samples through our so-called CCPM initiative that is led by Dr. Nick Wagley, and this has led to many insights about tumor evolution, and one of the main focus right now is understanding how cancers become resistant to hormonal therapy and CDK4/6 inhibitors. And finally, the clinical data allows our researchers to correlate new markers with clinical relevance. We do this with a variety of funding sources, but the sources that fund the infrastructure that relates to Embrace are grants from the National Comprehensive Cancer Network through a collaboration with Pfizer, the Breast Cancer Research Foundation, the Fashion Footwear Association of New York, and contributions from the PanMass Challenge, which I think many of you have either wrote in or contributed to, and this includes the Dana-Farber Women's Oncology team, as well as a team that is led by employees of ESI. So where were we before, where are we now, and what gives me hope? So now we'll get a little bit into the weeds. So we now know that breast cancer is not just one disease. There are three main subtypes of breast cancer: estrogen positive, HER2 positive, triple negative. And within these main three subtypes, there are many other ways we can further subdivide breast cancers. And we use this information to guide the kinds of treatments to recommend to patients. And more clinical trials will focus on very specific subtypes of breast cancer. This just shows the breakdown. Most commonly is estrogen receptor positive breast cancer, which makes up about two-thirds of the breast cancer that we see, HER2 positive and triple negative being somewhat less common but still important contributions from patients who have these subtypes. So where are we now? We have a better understanding of breast cancer subtypes. There are many more treatments available. We have a better ability to tailor treatments to specific features of the cancer or patients. And we pay much more attention, I hope, to quality of life, symptom management, and mental health than we have done in the past. And all of these, I think, have led to longer and better survival, although I think we all are here because we acknowledge and we recognize that we have a long way to go. I put up here a slide that just shows drugs approved by the FDA for treatment of patients with metastatic breast cancer, and these are all drugs that have been approved since 1995. If you look on this list, I'm sure that you will find something that you are either on now or you have been on in the recent past. And it's really sobering to think that in 1993, if you were diagnosed with metastatic breast cancer, these drugs did not exist. And so they include our common hormonal therapies like Femara or Faslodex, chemotherapies like capecitabine, Xeloda, or Ribulin, Halaven, all the HER2-based therapies like Herceptin, Perjeta, TDM1, and a whole list of targeted therapies which seems to grow every year, including medicines like Ibrance or Verzenio, Lynparza, Piqray, and Tecentriq. So I think that although it feels frustratingly slow for me, as well as I'm sure for you, the pace of progress, there really has been a tremendous amount of progress over the last 20 years. And this is not just in cancer drugs, but also the drugs that we use to support patients through treatment, including bone medicines, anti-nausea medicines. So imagine going through chemotherapy and there was no Amend or Aloxi or lots of anti-nausea medicines that we have today, antidepressants, growth factors. And this does not even include all the non-drug interventions that we many of our patients find very useful, including acupuncture and other therapies. So what do we want the future to look like? I think what we all want is more effective treatments with fewer side effects. We want a better ability to match the right treatment to the right patient. What we want to get to is a point where we minimize or eliminate death from metastatic breast cancer. And I think that we're at a point where we can really hope that someday we will find a cure for metastatic breast cancer. As we think about why has progress been so slow, in a way I think of curing cancer or treating metastatic breast cancer like building a skyscraper. And until really very recently, we were trying to build a skyscraper with stone hand tools. And that really is the reality. If we think about DNA, and people have heard that DNA is what you know, what you inherit from your parents and you pass down to your children, and in our DNA, there are 3 billion base pairs in the DNA. So this on this, you've seen this sort of double helix. Each one of those colored ladder steps is a so-called base pair. There are 4 letters that can be combined in all the different ways. And there are 3 billion of these pairs in our DNA. And if you can imagine, it just takes one change in one letter out of 3 billion base pairs in the gene BRCA1 to predispose a person to breast cancer. And you can imagine, to find that one change among 3 billion base pairs is like finding a needle in a very, very large haystack. And that's if we know exactly what we're looking for. But what if we don't even know what we're looking for? And what if every cancer is actually a little bit different? How do we do that? In 2001, there was a very big project funded by the NIH to sequence the DNA of basically one person. And that project took many years, and it cost $100 million. And you can imagine that if you want to study 100 people's cancers with estrogen positive, HER2 positive, triple negative, you know, you name it, breast cancer on a specific treatment, you can't do that if every sample costs $100 million in 10 years to do. In 2019, the same data can be generated with $1,000. And so you can just see that there's projects that we can do today that were completely impossible just 20 years ago. In addition, I think that we have, hopefully as a community, learned how to better partner with patients. Embrace is just one way, but Nick Wagley, who is a researcher here, leads these really amazing efforts, Count Me In, and the Metastatic Breast Cancer Project. Some of you may be part of these, and these are national initiatives. And basically, all of these initiatives are aimed at understanding, really from the patient perspective, if we take data that is from donated specimens from patients, and we pair it with exactly how people do, we hope that we can better understand what causes metastatic breast cancer, why it becomes resistant to treatment, and that should lead to better treatments and better and longer lives. And then once we get that, we need to test it in clinical trials. And clinical trials test new approaches. Sometimes they're entirely new drugs, sometimes they're new combinations, and sometimes they're new uses of old drugs. And every treatment that we give today is the result of information gained from patient volunteers in clinical trials. And what's different today than 20 years ago is going into a trial, we have a much better idea of the biology of the cancer and how the drug is supposed to work. And so I think we're going in with more confidence than before that the trial treatment has some chance of being helpful. This is an example, just one of many examples, really related to breast cancers that occur in patients who inherit the BRCA gene. And through an understanding of changes in this gene are associated with breast cancer, what does this gene do, and how can we take advantage of it to develop a drug? PARP inhibitors were developed. And this was a phase 3 trial that led to the approval of the drug olaparib, which showed that compared to traditional chemotherapy, in most cases intravenous chemotherapy, a once-a-day, twice-a-day pill was actually able to lead to double the likelihood of tumor shrinkage and a longer period of disease control. So I think it is not a perfect remedy, and eventually cancers get worse. But it shows us that by understanding the science, we really can develop better drugs. And finally, you heard from Dr. Weiner about quality of life. And I think that this graphic is really interesting to think about how you as our patients have really changed the way we take care of people with cancer. This is a graphic that shows, if you search into our what's called PubMed, that's how we find articles published in academic journals. And if you search quality of life and the phrase metastatic breast cancer, in 1980, there's basically one article that shows up. That's it. And you can see that there are more and more articles that show up. And I think that this is a reflection of what oncologists and oncology researchers consider important research to do, important research to publish and disseminate, and really what people consider to be important to pay attention to. So I hope that this continues to increase. This certainly is dwarfed by what we see for quality of life in survivors of early breast cancer, but I think we are making some progress here, and it really is due to very tireless efforts from patient advocates saying we really have to pay attention to quality of life. So this is my last slide, and I want to just again echo Dr. Weiner's comments that I hope that you will find today useful, and that you will take away from today some hope that we are making progress, albeit slower than we'd all like, and to share a little bit of that progress with you.